Hello, hello, and welcome back to the A Show with the Kings of Pro Wrestling Podcasts. Justin here with Meelz. Happy March. Meelz is almost over, but happy March.
It's almost over. Quarter one is almost over. That's how I view time now. Only in quarters. Oh, the working life. Quarter one is almost through. I'm good, man. How have you been? How's everything on your side?
Well, it's raining a lot. This is, what, week eight
of this stream? We're unsettling for this big event that's supposed to happen next week.
I know. It has not stopped. However, the forecast for next week looks... Hold on. Let's look.
Let's take a look.
Next week doesn't look too bad. Next week, sunny all next week. So we should be good. My issue is the 60-degree weather in California in March. That's the real question. That's not supposed to happen. That's usually like January, February, we kind of get that. And is when it's like 60 March, you would have never known that had ever happened. It's been cold. It snowed. I'm like, yo, what kind of day after tomorrow's type shit is we on right now?
Amen. No idea, but... Good Lord. I mean, I hope it's for the best because next week's a pretty big week. Next week is a lot of things going on. I mean, it's WrestleMania week in the city. I'm sure you'll feel it in the city based on how it all goes. Of course, next week we will have our WrestleMania prediction party as we do always. And we've already started recording and we already know how this is going to go. And you know what? There might even be a giveaway too if you like beating up your friends to a certain game, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. So you guys want to tune into that. I'm going to say immediately after uploading this on Patreon.
Okay.
Also available on Patreon will be Draft Diaries. Ooh. WrestleMania 19. So Justin and I went over 2 hours. Talk about it. We went over 2 hours, not only in just on WrestleMania 19, but Jay-Z's 2003. So you get that for full. And, you know, it'll be for those of you who don't have the Patreon yet, you're going to get it next week, but you're going to get an abridged version of it. Sorry, you got to make, you know, bang for your buck. Mm-hmm. You won't get all the Hove Chronicles and all the Rockafiles and all the other shit.
Rockafiles.
Right. Did you read Rockafiles?
No.
No? Oh my God. I wonder if the website is still up. It was like this. All right. I'm very ashamed of the thing. Rockafiles is like a fanfic website based on Rockefeller. Oh my God. All right. Well, whatever. I can't find it. It's probably dead.
It was probably on GeoSites, GeoCities.
Yeah, it was one of those. This is like 2004, 2005 thing. But yeah, man, listen, we got a lot of stuff coming. You know, the whole WrestleMania, you know, prediction party is going to be next week. You're going to get that. You're going to get a special episode of the War Report as they predict NXT Stand and Deliver, which looks fucking good, to be honest with you.
It's a heavy card. It's a really heavy card.
They told you, they said, wake your ass up.
Bring your ass up.
Wake your ass up, man. And bring it, you know what? Bring it to the card for NXT. Listen, they got Johnny Gargano versus Grayson Waller already. They got Bron Breakker versus Carmelo Hayes for the NXT championship already. They got a fatal four-way NXT women's championship ladder match, which I'm just assuming... Well, listen, I have my thoughts, but I'm sure it'll be uncovered all on NXT in the next coming weeks. We got Fallon Henley and Kiana James versus Alba Fire and Ela Dawn. Come on now. Mm-hmm. And we got Wesley beating off 5 other dudes with a stick for his NXT North American Championship.
You say beating off or beating up?
Beating up.
I listen.
Okay. It's okay. We're here. Listen, we're excited. Tis the season. You know what I'm saying? We get into all of it. Listen, by the time it's next week and you get that WrestleMania prediction party, you'll know everything you need to know. Like, we not only are you dropping gems on, like, you know, the card, but like how you're not going to get to wherever the hell you want to go unless you can be two people at once. And we talk all about it. So make sure you stay tuned to that. Listen, man, we got a special request for office hours this week.
Yes, we do. We do. And in the total lack and just complete utter transparency here, we are working super hard on the WrestleMania show next week. So it's a good thing there isn't a lot of news, and it's a good thing that we had some pretty solid shows this week where we won't have to like completely shit on everything. But You guys are getting like a 3-hour extravaganza next week. So this is why we're going to be doing a little bit of a more longer office hours, if that's okay with you, Meelz.
No, that's fine with me. Hold on, wait. Oh, I thought they... Listen, I got to stop reading Twitter. I thought they locked up Trump for...
Come on,
these
man.
These fucking pictures, man. The internet is crazy.
I don't think we'll ever see a president in handcuffs, but I think they hope if he has to surrender, then yeah, he'll surrender and there'll probably be a mugshot. But that's just crazy. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I'm willing to do if they ever show him them dragging him out the house, I'm willing to do a whole Twitch live, Kai Cenat style.
Nah, he would have to surrender. I just can't imagine him putting a president in handcuffs. But stranger things have happened, and nobody thought they would ever impeach a president twice. And look at where we were at.
Hey, for real. Let's get into these office hours.
Yeah, let's go.
So hold on. I gotta actually find it. I wanna find it. I know who it's from. Do we say who it's from? Does that matter?
No, it doesn't matter. It's from a couple of
Yeah, so hold on. Let me look it up. So we got essentially office hours from our Discord. Pretty much one of our members was essentially like, listen, I'm over my job. I'm over coming to this shit every day. Actually, I don't even know if I should hide it because Cyrus says it on his podcast every week. But but he says, I'm over it and I want to do something new, but I'm not really sure what to do. You know what I'm saying? Like the situation where you don't want to be doing what you're doing forever. Yeah. And you want to do something that excites you and that, you know, as a old LA Knight used to say, titillates you. And you want to have that kind of experience with what you
know. That wasn't LA Knight.
That wasn't LA Knight?
That was Max Dupree.
Oh, okay. Well, listen, Clark Kent, Superman, whatever the fuck you want to call him. You know what I'm saying?
He's LA Knight.
But... you know, I'm not okay. I found that exact. He says, because I don't want to work, I want a new job, but I don't know what I want to do instead of this. And I for sure as hell don't qualify for the cool shit I want to do. And says, so much on my resume.
You know what I say to stuff like that? Why don't you qualify? Why don't you qualify? You know what I'm saying? I feel like I feel like so many times mentally we cut ourselves off. So just full disclosure, like me and my wife are in the process of like, we're starting to look for somewhere to buy like a house or like a, well, we got to start with like a, we're going to have to start with like a townhouse or a condo, especially out here, which is the way that the housing market is, but we're probably going to move again. Okay. So she was like looking at something. She was just like, no, they're not even going to let us have a tour. They're not even going to let us or whatever. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, why? Why wouldn't they? Why? Mm-hmm. Why would? Why? Like, we have to stop cutting ourselves off from opportunities that are meant for us. You know what I'm saying?
By the way, hold on. Here comes the money. I couldn't do the thing that you had, but yeah.
Man, listen, it's out there. We went to a seminar last week about first time homeowners. And, you know, I looked at it not as this is what I can't do or this is where I'm going to stop myself from doing. I looked at it as, oh, oh, this shit is possible. All I got to do is think of it this way. I don't want to pay rent to somebody for the rest of my life. And that's why I'm like, I want to own something. And I'm like, there's ways that they want you. Here's the thing. Like when you look for a house, they want you to be there. They don't care how much credit you got or whatever. They're going to work with you. So to Cyrus's point, I would be like, why don't you qualify for that? Why don't you just apply anyway and see what happens? I think the one thing is just building your portfolio to do stuff like that. I think that a lot of times it's like, it's putting ourselves in position, because in going from, and you think about it, I went from editorial to marketing, music marketing, all the way to corporate at a pretty big, job that I'm at. You know what I mean? Like, these weren't things that I looked at like, I can't do this shit. You know what I mean? But I do feel like there's a sense of imposter syndrome that we have, where we say that, or we think that other people's journeys are more valid than ours. And I just don't think that's true.
I also think, just kind of piggybacking off of your point, I have several thoughts on this. One, because I've been through this before, but it really starts as an idea in your mind of like, what do I like to do and what could I see myself doing? And actually, sometimes you may not know that. I think that's one of the problems with the current system our current system. I don't want to say everyone's current system, because quite frankly, as people of color, we aren't given as many resources as, other people, which are pretty much what we can only see is a little bit compared to the whole thing. And I think that's a reason why sometimes we doubt ourselves. But I think you kind of have to take it from the vantage point of like, what do I want to do? Where do I want to go? That's one line of thinking. But also, when you do find that, you have to also realize, I got to start somewhere. Mm-hmm. And you gotta realize, like, that's why, to be honest with you, so much of this RNC radio stuff helped me get in the position that I am now, which is completely a pivot from where I was a year ago. And you gotta start somewhere, even if it's like grinding and stuff. And a lot of, getting interviews with WWE superstars and like helping coordinate interviews with like Kevin Durant and all these other people like that. Like, all this stuff builds up and it's equity and it's somewhere. You know what I'm saying? It starts somewhere, even if it's just a hobby, but you gotta start somewhere. And from there, you build the confidence, you build experience. You want to tap in a little bit more. I remember last year when I was looking for jobs in the field that I am in now, I was like, man, I got to make myself more attractive in a sense, because my fear of applying for jobs was always like, there's going to be a million people more qualified than me, like just off rip by default. There are people who went to school for this. There's people who are probably laid off their job but have experience than me. And I was like, so how can I make myself more attractive? And I would be like, okay, let me do this little training here. Let me go to this place. Let me do that place. And just like wherever opportunity arise, I kind of like put myself out there to kind of, receive it so it could help me in the long run.
Yeah.
But I do agree with you. And like, why don't you qualify? Like, why don't you can do anything that you really want to do.
And that sounds
really work towards it.
It sounds cliche. It does, but it's the truth. Like, why would you not give yourself that opportunity, that chance? Because at the very least, right? I always say this. What's the worst they could say to you? No.
Yeah.
That's not the worst thing that's ever been said to me.
But there's also the second point. So there's two major points in this. And the point is that, yes, you can absolutely do whatever you want to do if you don't qualify for it. But also, learning what you want to do is definitely like a process that comes like from within. I think there's a lot of people, I learned this in kind of high school, but a lot of people graduated. A lot of my friends graduated and decided they didn't want to go to college. They'll go to like the Army or the Navy and, no shots to anybody who like has served and stuff like that, like all power to you. But I always felt like that was a way of like, I don't know what I want to do, so I'm just going to let someone else figure it out for me. Mm. And part of that journey of life is kind of like trying new things and putting yourself out there in different things and seeing what kind of works for you. I wouldn't have got the last job I got if I wasn't unemployed as fuck. I was working at, I remember my first job out of college, I worked at Levi's for 2 days. I don't know if I've ever told the story on this podcast, but
oh, you were selling jeans?
Bro, I was in training for 2 days and I quit because
That's why you like the jeans nigga from My Hero, bro, because you was the jeans nigga.
Best genius?
Yeah. That
guy. No, but I worked there for 2 days, so I got hired. I went to the group interview, the group Think Me interview, killed it, bodied it. I was like, oh my God. All this public speaking from doing college radio really worked out for me because I like bodied all them 17-year-old kids.
Poor kid.
I get there, and then one thing, so I'd gone to, this is how you know it's a sign of the times. The previous night before I started my training, I went to a Ryan Leslie concert. It was free. New York summers are unmatched. At the time, now I don't even know at this point. They aren't doing anything for free anymore. But
you ain't outside. That's what this. You ain't outside. That's what I need.
No. I used to see Pusha T. I saw Pusha T like 3 times for free. He just does mad House of Van shit. But one thing he stuck with me is like, yo, why you working retail? You got a degree now, and not that I'm shaming working retail if you have a degree, but it really did stick in my head of like, yo, I could be doing so much more for something less. And one of my friends hooked me up with one of this job working in like essentially like construction management for schools. And I liked it because it was fulfilling, working schools, all this other stuff like that. And I did that for 8 years. But somewhere along the journey, I also decided I love talking about music, and I also met Justin, and I also met so many other people in my life that kind of like helped change my trajectory on like what I want to do and what I could do, because I saw so many people just like me doing it as well. So even when I was working that construction management job, I was doing everything on the side, like freelancing and doing these podcasts and designing things and doing so much more and like putting myself out there, talking to people. This is how I met you. I met Adele. I met Jeff J, Kaz, all these other people, like putting myself out there to really do these things. And I think that all helped with the experience that I had just in life, saying like, you know what, this would be a cool thing to kind of like do full time, but I was always afraid because of like job security and still am, but I took the leap anyway because, and I feel more satisfied doing it. I never will go back to what I was doing because I feel ultimately like this is, I'm heading in the direction that I want to go. And I right. think when you want to, when you don't really know what to do, I say put yourself out there and try new things. And
because yeah, I mean, if you can say I don't want to do what I'm doing anymore, look at what other people kind of did to get to where they're at. Like, it's really never too late to get there. I think, and it's tough to really say because a lot of times your reputation kind of, you know, will precede itself. I say like hop on LinkedIn, let these people know you open to work so they can see what you do and what you've done. Put yourself out there, like Meelz said. I think a lot of it is really diversifying what you do and seeing what you really want to do and putting yourself in position to be around people that do those same things. Like, if it's something where it's like, oh, somebody wants to be a developer or a technical animation person or something like that, where I'm at, I'd be like, okay, well, I'll let you in anyway. You know what I'm saying? Because you're at least in the system. You know what I'm saying?
Or like, if you want to read manga for a living, and all you're just like, you know what? I'll use the funds that I have in my job right now to buy myself a Fire camera and some editing software and doing all these other things. And I'll learn how to do it all on YouTube, and I'll open up a Twitch channel, and then I'll connect. Like, there's so many different options now of things to do. That's not only like you could be working for someone else, but you could work for yourself. Like,
yeah, it's definitely, and again, I hate to keep saying it's out there. Just go get it. Like, it is there. It's there. Like, I for one want people to get it earlier than I did, but I never had somebody telling me the stuff that we kind of tell people on this. You know what I mean? Like, it's something where we put ourselves around people. And I'm guessing this is your point too, is that you put yourself around people that had the same goals that you did. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or people that had accomplished something or had been accomplished, and you kind of learn, take it from the learning tree. And I think that's a big thing about, you know, RNC as a whole as well, is that like when I kind of created that, it was like, it was stewardship. It was creating an opportunity where people could pass it forward. to do different things. And it's like, yo, like, you have a support system of, you know, black men that have made it, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, obviously we've grown and bigger and bigger and bigger. It's not just that anymore, but, you know, it's a brotherhood, you know what I mean? Where it's like, yo, if you need to lean on me for something, just ask. If I can't do it, it doesn't mean that I don't care, but, you know, we're both learning together. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're all learning together. And I think through anything, just looking at the prestige and everything that have come out of it, it worked. You know what I mean? It's really worked. And I've learned a lot just from being around all of you guys. You know what I'm saying? And I've taken some things and implemented it into my own strategy as, you know, somebody in the workforce. But I mean, ultimately, and Meelz, what would be your ultimate goal though? Like in the end, like, cause I'm coming up to that age where it's like, where do I want to be at? And I think that my goal right now is like, I want to be able to take my kids to school and pick them up every day. And I want to have a work schedule that works around that. You know what I'm saying? I want to be able to still live my life and do what I got to do, but come into an office and say, hey, I showed up and I'm out. You know what I mean? Like, that's my ultimate goal. Or just work.
That's what I wanted for years. Yeah.
Or just, I'm almost there. I haven't been in an office since 2019. I'm almost there.
Yeah. This is kind of like what we wanted. And it's important to like say these things so they're kind of out there and you really have something to work towards. It's really finding what you want to work towards and then kind of understanding what the steps you need to get there are also part of the journey as well. And I feel like sometimes because we're doing so much like week after week, you can get kind of like caught up in just the grind and just trying to keep up. And it's with so many things in life because it's hard out there. Like it really, really is. And you get caught up in like, you get exhausted from just existing. You know what I'm saying? Like, my car broke down, I got bills to pay, eggs is fucking $8, so many other things that are going on. Like, you get caught up in just existing, and it's really hard sometimes to be able to like kind of like pause and be like really take a look at yourself. But it's definitely worth it. I always implore like really like kind of look within, take some time to yourself, explore different things. I realize now, like just having this conversation, I'm like, between in college when I was doing my engineering degree to like what I grew up, I mean, what I kind of like did for the last 8 years. While it was very structured, I realized I always kept myself around creatives. And that always kind of kept me sane. And Cyrus, I think it's the same way for you too, because honestly, your line of work, I know you're around creatives all the time. Mm-hmm. So I think it's the same way with you, but like, and that kind of like feeds that. So keep yourself around people and always have that support system and push it in the right direction. And you know, your friends will help you along the way. If there's anything that was like, you know, I used to do this for my, you know, my radio station students all the time. I was like, yo, put me on your resume that I was your supervisor and I'll tell them everything. Like, I don't give a fuck. Like, I'll be your resource. Like, I'll be, if you need to get that job, I'll help you get that job. Like, if you need like to fake that, you know, I'm your supervisor on this thing. I won't say fake, but like, cause I was, but I'll help you do that. And I think that's a part of what community also brings to this as well. It's just like looking around, being inspired by the people you are.
An issue is I never really know just specifically with Cyrus, I never really know if he having these, you know what I'm saying? It's like, I know he hates his job, but I don't really know what he want to do. So if I know
what do you love?
Yeah. Like if you know what you want to do, then yeah. But I think it wasn't just him that had the same kind of question.
Nah, there's a couple more people.
Yeah, I know Viz, I believe, was one of somebody to co-sign this, and I think it still applies to everybody there. It's like, you know, go after what you really want to do, but put yourself around those people that do it. And you know,
when my coworkers were literally, you're about to quit the job at the same time, she's like, I want to work at a coffee shop, and I'm like, why? And she was just like, I just want to try something new, I just want to do something different for a while. And I understand that, because like, you really get lost in the monotony of it all and like the grind and the race to like kind of keep up. It's rare you get to do things that you want to do, but it's so fulfilling at the same time. And it's such like great energy to be doing that. So I understood it. Now she got an actual job doing some other things, but
it's reality.
Yeah. Yeah. No. Yeah, absolutely. But like, try something new.
Yeah.
Try something new.
that's really just the long and short of it, is that that is my key to any of y'all. Do not cut off your own blessings before you even get them, bro. Like, just it's definitely possible. You just have to. I mean, I apply to shit that I don't feel like I could do all the time. And
yeah, you tell me to do that, I'll be like, nigga, you bugging. What?
Do it.
You tell me to do it, and I'm like, huh? Why would I?
Why not?
Director. I mean, I probably could, but I don't know if I should.
Here's the thing. If you don't, if they see your resume, I've had times where they've seen it and I've got a call back and they say, you might not work for this, but you work for this. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's happened to me a lot. I had an interview. I was interviewing you. I think I told you this. I was interviewing Netflix for like 3 months. And they were like, you might not fit here, but you'll probably fit over here. And you know, eventually I didn't get it, but it opened up the door for me to have my situation that I'm in now. You know, So again, you never know where it's going to take you if you just kind of really believe in your own skills and you know, have a belief in not only your skills, but your personality, what you offer, what you bring to the table, all of that stuff. Like, you can do this shit.
Hey, man, y'all got more office hour questions. We got the time.
I want to get workplace tea.
You want to do what?
I want to get workplace tea. I want to do like something in the workplace.
Qualms in the workplace. I ate my lunch.
Drama in the workplace. You know what I'm saying? Let's get
that. Should I still go back into work?
yeah, that's what we need to get to on office hours, man. Like, that's really what I want to talk about. Workplace.
Our doors are always open.
What's the news this week?
Big news. Yesterday, my man, Big Bill Goldberg, free agent, WWE contract expirando. You know what I'm saying?
Could kind of guess that Triple H was not going to read this up.
Hey, man, was it? I could have guessed that from his Tough Enough 2 promo 20 years ago.
Yeah, you could guess that he was not going to read this up. I'm not shocked. I honestly don't think that
he probably said it like, listen, we hired back top dollar Karrion Kross thing. You know, Goldberg is coming off the books pretty soon. Like, I think we could afford it. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. I think you let that lapse. I think as constructed right now, there is really no room for a Goldberg. He's had the Brock match. He's had the Bobby match. You don't really want him beating Austin Theory right now. I don't think there's anything to a Seth Goldberg match, especially where Seth is as a babyface. Roman ain't doing it again. You don't want him to squash guys like Karrion right now. Like, it's just not, which, I mean, it would be fun to see Karrion and Goldberg and Karrion have to sell that shit. But like, that's a little bit too much eating shit. You know what I mean? Like, for people who just come back to get squashed by Goldberg, I'm sure they think it would be cool, but I don't think it would help anybody.
I've in terms of Goldberg's run, for the majority of it, I liked it. And I thought one of the most random fire things he did was when he randomly showed up to SummerSlam to kill Dolph Ziggler.
Yeah.
I thought that was fire. I was like, oh crap, that was kind of cool. But I think for the most part, other than the Undertaker match, which kind of went awry, and it's a shame they didn't do it again, but Taker was probably like, yeah, I'm not doing that shit again. Brett told me not to.
It was a bridge too far for him.
Yeah, but I think for the most part, he's played his role. He's he worked very hard in being in the shape and promising what he could. He did it for so long. His son is a damn grown up at this point.
Yeah.
That little, you know, I don't, you know what? Let me not say anything about anyone's children.
You saw what he did when Bobby fucked him. I wouldn't do it.
But wait, do you think he could? Do you think he could?
Could what? I am not dignifying that with even a thought right now.
Hey, man, listen.
That man has way bigger problems than bringing in a Goldberg.
Jericho Appreciation Society. You know, you could bounce a couple of them off his damn shoulders.
Goldberg would expose everything going on there and would not give a shit. He's at that age where he doesn't have to care. And at that money level, he's not like a Jake the Snake or like a Billy Gunn. Like, he made a lot of money in this business. He would literally be like, this is some ghetto shit.
Hey, man, I say that all the time, but then I see like Paul White go over there.
Christian. When has Paul White not been ghetto? You know what aesthetic. The Big Show is ghetto as fuck. He's just a ghetto ass character. Whose favorite wrestler is The Big Show? Exactly. I don't know. Exactly. That's just straight up in the ghetto, bro. Like, I feel like if you saw what happened with Wardlow, who was the Batista Goldberg equivalent in that company.
Wardlow ain't got no damn.
What? That's
got no.
That's what they said.
No, but he ain't got no pull. He ain't Goldberg. Wardlow don't ring bells like that.
But hold on. If that was, again, supposed to be a new star that he was going to build, and he couldn't even do that there, how is he gonna do it with Goldberg, especially with the egos in AEW, the people who don't enjoy what Goldberg brings to the table, who are completely staunchly against sports entertainment? You're gonna piss off Eddie Kingston? You're gonna piss off fucking the empty headed fuck Hangman Adam Page? You're gonna piss off a lot of people bringing him into the company.
I don't know about that, but I don't know. It would kind of be up to him. I could see your way, but I could also see him like perfect. I feel like he's not the same. He's clearly not the same Goldberg as in 1999 and 2001, 2000, or even 2003, the jaded kind of thing. He went in, he said, listen, let me trust this. And for all, you know, things, the business has been good to him for like the last 5 years or so. By all stretch of imagination. Could he decide? My only thing is, like, there's a lot of unscripted, it's not as structured over there as it is in WWE, which I think could probably end up with Goldberg flying, like, WCW stuff happening to him. So that would be my only fear.
He's not going to take some of those bumps. You'd have to put him against somebody like a Samoa Joe, who could mentally work with somebody like that. And
Jericho or Jared or...
Yeah, who wouldn't have an ego. Who would not have an ego working with him. So that leaves you, Meelz, with about four people. Okay, he could probably... They only have a very set amount of pay-per-views a year. If he does come in, you know what's going to happen next, Meelz. They're going to start saying, when is he going to become the AEW World Champion? You're not keeping him away from that title. So at that point, it becomes... Are you going to have him do a 20-minute match with MJF when you know Goldberg doesn't do those well? Mm-hmm. Are you going to squash MJF and then have him win the title? Are you going to beat Goldberg? These are questions that, again, WWE managed to answer more often than not in a sensical manner. Case in point, the Brock Lesnar feud, where it made sense there. I don't see anyone to that level where they could have a knockdown. He gets put in a one wing angel, it kicks out. What's that gonna make? You know what I'm saying?
He gets up, to be honest with you.
But, he's not doing that bump. Is he gonna listen to Tony Khan?
I mean, I don't know. He listens to anybody who pays him.
Is he gonna listen to Tony? Because, I mean, come on. There's a certain level of respect that people have for a Triple H or a Vince.
Also, Tony Khan probably don't fuck with Goldberg. You probably find, listen, the day we find this man's pro boards account, you know, the day we find this man's GameVax account, TK is real, 2297. You know what I'm saying? The day we find it and figure out what he's been saying on the internet is going to be a very funny day.
I can't see it. I mean, someone would have to prove me wrong, but I really can't. I can't see it. I think that it would be. And again, put him next to anybody on that roster, he's going to look like a mammoth. Next, I'm not going to believe that he can beat anybody or that anyone is going to be a sizable enough opponent for him, except for Samoa Joe. Wardlow is very small. He's big for them. But he's not bigger than Goldberg, or bigger than what Goldberg could be when he gets in the ring shape.
I mean, this is very, very true.
Cassidy next to Goldberg.
Adam, sure they'll cheer.
Adam Cole next to Goldberg. If that gets a holy shit, I swear to God.
It might. You never know.
Dog, it's gonna be like me next to Goldberg getting a holy shit.
Hey man, I'd pop.
You pop because I'm about to die, that's why.
Hey man. All right now. Well, speaking of from one contract that's expired to another. Mm. Miss Mercedes Mone, Mone Watch.
Oh my god.
She says she sat down at whatever con that she was at. What was it? Planet Comic Con in Kansas City. She was asked by a fan if she considered returning to WWE phones from Vince McMahon retirement. And she says, first of all, nobody knows the story. You don't know the story, but you're reading whatever you want to read and believing who you want to believe.
She's a character?
No, she wasn't a character.
Okay.
Maybe a little bit. Nobody knows the story because I haven't said anything. And I'm not going to say anything because that's just the classy boss that I am, the CEO. So she was kind of in character.
She was in character. He has never done an interview out of character.
All right, so she's never going to say anything, but
here's the thing.
I wonder why.
You said it perfectly. You said it perfectly on Twitter, Meelz.
I said it to my close friends, but you can share this, yes.
Well, they can't find it, so they can't say shit about it if they're not even close friends. She's going to look crazy if she does. And you know what? It's the fucking truth. There's so much truthiness to that because she's absolutely going to look crazy if she sits down and says, and you know, with almost a year removed from this, I think the emotions have subsided. But I've stuck to the same thing that I've said for a whole year. If you said this to anybody in the world, the purported reason why they left, they would look at you like you were crazy. Because at the end of the day,
apparently it's not true.
You did not want brother. I think that's the reason why neither of them have said anything about it, because it's about losing a fake title or losing a fake match. You weren't even gonna lose a title. You're losing a fake match that's gonna lead you to another match at another show. The
She's
world
not saying anything.
The world is so much bigger than whatever the fuck that problem was that was going on. The world is so much bigger than that. And here's the thing. Nothing's changed in the company. They have not stopped making money. They've only made more money. They've got better ratings since she's left. Why wouldn't you tell the story now? If there was a story to tell, you know why, Meelz? Because there is no story to tell.
Well, it's not only her story to tell as well.
Oh, so who else?
Naomi. You would have to incorporate her in the story.
I'm the waist trainers. I know the story. I don't need her story.
I think they should tell the story.
Why?
I want to hear the story. I want to hear it. I want to see if it. I have my suspicion. I mean, you, at the end of the day, you walked out. So it is what it is. They're going to say, like, they walked out for this reason. They walked out for that reason. Unless it was, like, racism, sexism, something along those lines, which I'd find hard to believe in the women's division. I mean, I don't want to say I find it hard to believe, but.
It wouldn't be that. It would have come out.
Yeah.
It would have come out. It was that she would have said it.
But
there's nothing in this world right now that would where anyone would have to be quiet or silent about that type of stuff anymore.
Is it just like they've been playing in my face for years? Like, that's what I feel like it is. From her perspective.
But from her perspective, if she were to say that story, the blowback would be huge also, because you've got plenty of people in there who she's walked out on that would then speak up. This is like reality. It's like reality TV. Like if Sasha says something, people are gonna clap back. I'm not calling her Mercedes. If Sasha says something, is people gonna keep clapping back?
A couple of weeks ago, Charlotte Flair. A week ago, Charlotte Flair talked about Mercedes Mone.
Ostrabeck.
Leaving. She said, I think it's cool whenever someone follows their heart. And that's inspiring. There will never be another group like the Four Horsewomen ever. I was like, that was so nondescript.
Says a lot. Says a lot without saying anything, doesn't it?
It was just like, that was so nondescript. You didn't even say her name.
Says a lot without saying anything, doesn't it?
I mean, it's inspiring when someone follows their heart.
What you think it mean?
I think it's inspiring whenever someone follows their heart. Sometimes if that's how you want to fly, that's when you fly. You know what I'm saying? I think Charlotte's like, she ain't walk out on me. So, I mean, you know.
Oh, I doubt she would feel that way. I feel like if Charlotte were to, I do feel like she, there, even if she isn't like the most liked person online, I feel like a lot of people do respect her in that locker room.
Yeah. I feel.
She ain't never walked out.
Yeah, and I just don't think it's like, to me, just kind of that response is like, it's cool, but realistically, we have other things to worry about. Like, I bet if they ask, do you hope, you know what, let me shut up. I feel like I'm stirring the pot. I was like, would you be happy if Naomi came back? It's like, I wish Naomi would come back. I wish Naomi would come back, damn it.
Why?
I like Naomi.
But she,
not
she,
that I don't like, yeah, not that also again that I don't like Sasha Banks, but I really like, I think she's one of the most genuine baby faces as ever existed on the roster. And I always felt like she never used, she was always getting it out of the mud. So you just wanted to see her awarded for that. And it's always nice because that's like genuine love for people. I have the same love that I have for Naomi for Liv. Like, you want to see these people win at the end of the day. I don't care about like, Naomi's got to be part of the Bloodline thing. I feel like that is dumb. But I want to see her win at the end of the day. I don't know what went into whatever decision that she made last year, but I want to see her win at the end of the day. Just like her homegirl is apparently winning.
I feel like she got out there, put herself all the way out there. I'm sure she's happy, but outside looking in, the optics are crazy in terms of like where she is and what Sasha's been doing. The optics are wild. They're wild and wildly inconsistent. Wouldn't you say so?
I would say so.
Okay.
Two little bit of AEW news. Taya Valkyrie is now All Elite.
All right.
Damn. Okay. All right. AEW had a house show over the last weekend. House rules.
What do you say about that?
I don't know.
Wait. Taya Valkyrie. She's a great hand, skilled worker.
There you go.
What is she gonna do to make those women better? Because as you're gonna get to, the house show was last weekend, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we saw the top woman in the division having what looked like, I have no clue. You know how when back in the day we used to go to like house parties and a girl, you used to get a dub on a girl.
Of course. And
you had no clue. Like, she was just wild. You had no clue how to get the rhythm.
Absolutely. Hold me up, Mark.
they ain't had nobody to hold them up. But that's what I look like.
I feel, so with Taya, I feel like people are like booking this, like, people are booking it as if she could win the title. I don't think she's winning that TBS title. I think she came in as another strong hand. She's really good at what she does. Great talent, great worker. I have no, unless she does something amazing within the next year or it leaves the same impact that she left, ironically, on Impact. I can't see anything in the short term of like a championship or a major win. So that's that. Also, I approach. Probably gonna be on Rampage this week. She was on Rampage last week. Never mind. Funny how that turned out. House shows.
If they don't give a fuck, why should we?
Amen.
if they don't get, like, seriously, if they don't give a fuck, why should I give a fuck about her signing? Because they immediately put her on the show that only 400,000 people watch a week.
They even less this week.
It was less this week?
No, it was preempted this last week.
Oh yeah, it's a midnight. But if they immediately put her on that show, why then should I get up in arms about anything that is going to happen to her? And if they do have her lose to Jay, that is a damn shame.
Oh wait, no, Rampage did solid last week. Oh, look at that. Did 474.
That's solid. For them, that's solid. You're right. For them, that's solid.
That's all right. Yeah, that's all right.
For them. Yeah, I she's a great hand. I'm actually kind of shocked that the Triple H didn't bring her back. Aren't you?
No, I'm not shocked.
Yeah.
She would have been good, but nah. I think we brought enough people back.
Yeah, you don't really need her. Yeah, you're right.
She wasn't the first call, the second call, or the third call. So,
well, Sasha don't want to come back, so I do want to come back. Like,
yeah, man, her line was not hit fast enough, or maybe it was, and maybe she was under contract. Who knows? But she's free now, so it is what it is.
What's the other, this house show?
House show. They did. Apparently did really well for the venue that they were at.
Was it like a pigsty? What was it? Where was that?
I'm kidding. That's hilarious. You know, they did their little venue, little 3,000 seater, you know what I'm saying? But they did good. A lot of people got on the show. They had Claudio and Claudio, you know, what's his name? Moxley. Versus
Bill,
Big Bill, and
the Negro.
Don't say that. What's his name?
The Negro.
God, no, he has a name.
That's what they could. That's might as well be what his name is on the damn on the show.
You said that's on the run sheet. That's what they name him.
Yeah, the Negro.
Oh God, ah. I'm changing his name now.
Lee Moriarty.
Lee Moriarty. There you go. He's not on the show enough for me to know. But, and our guy Stokely having a match this week on Dynamite. More power to him.
Okay.
But, you know, a lot of people got reps on the show, you know. So I heard it was a fun time for all involved. So hopefully they keep doing it. People get these reps.
You being so nice right now.
No, but I mean... House shows is what they need, right? House shows legitimately.
Be real. I need you to be real.
House shows are what they need.
Yes. These
people need to know how to wrestle often in front of a crowd, and they get no time on TV to be able to do this. I'm surprised Jade Cargill was not on this house show, because This is what everyone has been talking about her needing more reps in the ring. And this is a great opportunity to do so. But to be quite frankly with you, she probably like, if I'm not getting paid for it, I'm not going.
Exactly. And who the fuck? It's going to be the same. She's going to get a jobber. And it's going to be this. It's going to work the same way that it worked on regular shows.
But if they, so let's say if they did, like, for instance, they wouldn't do this on TV. But if they did a house show, Jade Cargill versus like Hikaru Shida, I'd be interested to go to that house show just to see it. I mean, they're not going to do it on TV, but at least they could do it at a house show. See how it goes. See how it works. I think that's the benefit of, I'm trying to look on, you know, this isn't a bad thing. The house rules thing isn't a bad thing, is essentially what I'm saying.
But again, they don't do them enough for it to matter. And you know what else? They do these matches and go straight home. They don't go and continue to work on their craft.
It's true. I do be watching Isaiah Cassidy's YouTube channel.
Exactly.
He could be on vacation every week. I'd be like, God damn. He got the gym once a week. Hit the show. And whatever town he's in, he's going on an adventure.
Hustled that check. He said, thanks, Tony. And then he's out.
Hey, man. Go watch Isaiah Cassidy's thing. What else is there? to say. The Bella Twins are gone from WWE. They said they are not joining AEW.
All right.
So, you know, started one thing, ended it right there. You wanted to say a little bit of news about our homeboy, Dwayne Johnson.
Yes, yeah. Allegedly, people think that. Here's my thing. So a news piece came out today about Dwayne Johnson and his attempts to kind of make the DC Universe stuff about him. Obviously, Shazam 2, which is part of the... Well, Black Adam is part of Shazam's story, which is funny because they're doing it the other way, where Black Adam is just kind of his own nigga, and he don't have nothing to do with nobody with Superman, which nobody was ever going to buy, right? So I think that this piece came out kind of confirming a lot of things that people kind of already guessed and knew, and people are kind of framing it as a hit piece. I'm not really into kind of getting into the mechanics of that because they did it to Tom Cruise. They've done it to a lot of people. This happens in Hollywood. People talk and then people put their narratives out there. Like The Rock is not new in terms of getting these types of things happening to him, right? But I say that to say that with stuff like this coming out, how could anybody have thought The Rock was going to do some type of prolonged storyline on this show with the way Roman and Cody have been cutting promos for the past month and a half? This nigga would be in the back with angry tears every single night with the shit that they would be saying to him. Because you got to be real, right? You can't. Absolutely. The Rock has to be, as a character, he has to come off as infallible. He has to come off as perfect, chiseled, the most perfect man that has ever known. You know what I'm saying? He can't have mistakes. That's why when Cena pointed out these mistakes 10 years ago, that got under his skin because it showed that he had a chip in his armor, or really a chip on his shoulder. So coming into WWE, a place where, again, you're working at Mania with a smarter crowd who can easily say, chant Black Adam sucks or you got fired or something like that to throw him off his game, which we know he could be thrown off of just by looking at the way he reacted at the Oscars 2 weeks ago when someone asked him about it. And he said, the fans loved it. Critics had an agenda out for me. Like, come on, Meelz. Come on. You're still doing it. You're still like, there was no way he was showing up getting promos cut on him about any of this stuff and him being okay with it. He called Cena punk motherfucker or some shit. What'd he call him? Like, what do you think he was going to call a nigga Roman if he did that?
Right. You know, Brian Gewirth's probably selling his book and probably don't have time to help write all the creative for this shit anyway.
What creative could he even, you know what I'm saying? Like, what creative could he even have right now? You know what I mean?
Man, Brian Gewirth's approved creative, brother.
True.
With the man, bro. You live with the man. I could still see him. I mean, I don't think he will. I mean, maybe he could still show up to WrestleMania.
He could still show up.
I would love to see The Rock and Stone Cold in the ring with LA Knight. I would love to see LA Knight. I was like, I'm going to find my way to LA WrestleMania. And then, like, you know, glass shatters or if you smell or something along those lines. And we get groovy that way. I would love to see that.
Because at least I would know that LA wouldn't go off script the way that Roman would have to.
No.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, Roman would have to go off script in order to kind of get the program over. And we're going to talk about that promo with Cody in a little bit. But it gets more heat to the program. But people would look at it as he's trying to bury Roman when it would really just be trying to get people to feel more bad for, you know, for Rock. But the thing is, again, how can we as fans who are used to people in this generation of wrestling, right? We're used to having characters that we can have sympathy for. The Rock is a character that by all intents and purposes in this generation, people should and would probably boo. He'd have to be a heel because he comes off as an infallible narcissist. And I don't know if that many people are into that.
Right. No, you're right.
the reason why Cody's getting it right now is because people have sympathy for him and they have sympathy for his story. The Rock and Roman, there would be no, it would be two perfect and valuable dudes fighting. It would be boring. And it's a little different than Brock because Brock is kind of like a beast, a monster. Like, we don't really need to have sympathy for that. But remember when they tried to do that for Goldberg with his son in order to give him a different page to his story? I just don't see, like, and I don't see Rock taking that story and making it, you know, real life either. Like, I'm down on my luck. Hollywood's turned their back on me. I just don't see him doing that, yo. I just don't. Just the way his ego is, I just don't see it.
I agree.
Want to get into the shows?
Let's get into the shows.
It'd be pretty easy this week. It wasn't a. It was it really this week was we got to get these. We have to get these matches announced, and we have to get these programs over. That was this week.
It was like, we still got to book matches. We booking WrestleMania, baby. We still got to. Someone got to figure out these damn shows. That's exactly what these shows were, because we got Santos Escobar and Zelina versus Dominic and Rhea Ripley. We got Sheamus versus Drew with no fucking finish. We got Xavier Woods versus LA Knight on SmackDown. But what would you, I mean, the most notable thing on SmackDown, I would say.
Yeah, talk about
finally,
it.
We finally got, well, actually, there's two notable things. I'm bugging. I mean, there's one, but we finally got Charlotte Flair and Rhea Ripley to put hands on one another.
Yes, sir.
And boy, did they put hands. Charlotte put some feet in there, too.
I said, there you go. As soon as you saw the shoes come off, I said, it's time for the pull-apart brawl. And I'm glad
to keep it a buck. I feel like this is Triple H booking. Triple H love a good pull-apart.
He's done it quite a couple times, yeah.
But Charlotte loves a good pull-apart, too. She was like, give me that pull-apart. I need that.
Pull apart,
gets take your shoes off.
Pull apart gets me over. Gets us both over. He's like, yeah, all
man.
Right.
She beating up security like Wardlow, man. So she got 16 championships, and Wardlow got.
That's why it's not impressive when Wardlow do it, because Charlotte do it every week.
Charlotte do it in a bodysuit.
Yeah, Wardlow. You ain't doing it like Charlotte doing it. I'm just saying.
I love that they got to put their hand in each other. I don't think, to be honest with you, I don't think the promo material is that inspiring at all. I feel like Rhea Ripley, one, she's still not hated. Two, I think she has this idea in her head of why she needs to face Charlotte and beat Charlotte, but I'm still not really believing it. I would love if Charlotte, I mean, she can't really beat an underdog because she's a 14-time fucking world champion, but I would love from a vantage point of there being a little bit more than just, I have to beat her because I'm the best. And there's rooms for that kind of program, but I don't know. I'm just not believing it. I'm not believing it, but.
Violence.
It's it. Yeah, we're going to get violence. It's to me, I think. To me. This match isn't quite worthy of the main event yet.
No,
but I know what match is. Because Friday on SmackDown, first of all, we kicked off the show with Cody being like, I'm going to invite my man Kevin Owens out here.
Cody, Minister Cody Farrakhan.
Cody watched Soul Food the past weekend. He was like, I'm going to do a little bit of this and I'm going to do a little bit of that. To which Kevin Owens said, oh, yeah. Kevin Owens is like, all right, so what do you want me out here for? He's like, I came out here to bring out Sami Zayn. And here comes Sami Zayn. He steps out here. It's an ambush. KO's like, what is this?
An emotional ambush.
Amen. He was like, I know I was with them. Kevin Owens is like, you know, the family fucked my husband or whatever the they said in Soul Food. The bloodline. the bloodline messed up my friendship. You know what I'm saying? And you were a part of it. And you know, Sami Zayn's like, all right, we don't have to be friends. It was very much giving like Martin Gina, I'll marry you, okay?
No, he said no. He said, Gina, will you marry me? Damn, are you happy?
We can just do this as friends. We don't have to be friends. To which KO says, why would I do this if you don't want to be my friend?
Ooh.
And then that's when the music should have hit. You know, not the sad music, the somber music. Because even Cody was like, damn, I don't. Cody mouth was shut. He was like, first time he ain't had nothing to say.
Yeah, he said, I don't got nothing to say. Sammy, you better make this right.
He was like, damn, I wish I had friends. All my friends in Jacksonville. End of the show. Sami Zayn gets into a battle of words. They had a confrontation. There's some shit I would do, but over the phone.
You missed the part where KO is about to drive off.
Oh yeah, KO is about to drive off in his green little, you know, rented number. And Sammy's like, wait. I forgot what Sami actually said. What did he say?
Sami said, hey, I know I said all this. I know, you know, regardless of this, you don't have to, you know, work with me, but I just want you to know, like, I'm going to this the wrong way. And listen, if I don't got nothing else to say, then shit, I love you. And then KO was like, this motherfucker right here got me.
Amen. If they had filmed a driving sequence of this man driving down the highway, and some song comes on. You know what I'm saying?
When they song when they used to drive. What would it be? What would it be?
What's that Guitar Hero song?
Oh gosh.
One of those numbers. You know what I'm saying?
Like, hold on, damn. Hold on. But I mean, what if it's a lot more? I feel like they're not listening to that together.
All right. What do they listen to together then?
You know what they listening to?
Go ahead.
Listening to this.
I can't even hear it.
You can't hear it?
No.
Yo, Zencaster cock blocks the whole thing. Mary J. Blige, be without you.
Why would they play Mary J. Blige, be without you? That's funny as hell. Hold on.
Why wouldn't they play it? Hold on. We getting these songs off. There you go.
He's driving down the highway. He's like, damn, Mary, kill this one. I gotta remember to get tickets to her show. And then he pulls up to a stop sign. He looks up at the billboard. It says WrestleMania.
In Kansas City?
They're doing it's a nationwide campaign.
Okay, gotcha.
And then
Roman is the man. I got the one. I got it. Ready?
All right, what are we doing?
It's this one.
Remember, I was your hero. That was it.
Yeah.
I'd wear your heart like a symbol. I couldn't save you from my darkest truth of all.
Gotta let it hit. Hold on.
I know.
Uh-oh, here you go.
I'll always be less than zero. Oh, yeah. You tried your best for me, I know.
That's the song.
So you know what he does? He makes a U-turn down a one-way.
What time is it though? It's 9:50. He's got to make it back because he knows it's a setup.
Hey man, he careens down the street, passing through sidewalks. You know, gets in traffic, Kansas City traffic, whatever that means. Gets out. It just says, "Not fucking. I gotta book it to the arena. I gotta save my friend." Meanwhile, in the ring. Jey Uso, Sami Zayn. I don't know what kind of conversation. The conversation would have been over after he beat my ass last week. We would have been talking about nothing.
I'm barfing in the break.
Yeah. Beat us both down last week. But Sami Zayn was like, you don't hate me, Jey. You hate that I was the one that hit Roman Reigns with the chair when deep down, you know that you've always wanted to be the one to hit him with the chair. And I was like, oh my God.
Jay was so fire in this segment too, because there's parallels there between Jay and KO coming back to the families, the respective mm-hmm. families, right? Where it's like these families have run them both ragged and tested them mentally, physically, emotionally over the years. And this is really like, you know, they came back to support their brothers. You know what I mean? And I think that's one of the best stories about it, as well as like, again, you got to think that Cody's like, me and my brother went through the same thing. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Me and my brother fight all the time. Me and my brother fought in a company multiple times. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think that there's parallels there with family. And I think that that's what I love the most about this build. This to me has been the most, not just A to B, but multi-layered WrestleMania builds in a really, really long time, because there's a lot going on and all of it is over and popular. And I would say that, like, even besides the Bloodline thing, because my thing is like a rising tide kind of lifts all boats, right? Like, by proxy, you've had Sheamus intertwined with this as well, but now people are invested in seeing him win the IC title against Gunther. But they also have Drew there too, who they love as well. So they're torn. So that program's over. You know what I'm saying? And then you have fucking the Seth Logan thing that people are fucking into because they just hate. Like there's so many programs that have been really built super well here that I'm like way more excited for this Mania than we were talking about this same type of show last year, Meelz.
The end of SmackDown, KO's music hits as the Usos is beating him down. He rushes to the ring and, you know, evens the odds. People go fucking nuts. Kansas City's losing this shit. Kevin Owens stares at Sami Zayn from across the ring. He lunges towards Sami Zayn. Sami Zayn
starts backing up.
Yeah, he starts backing up. I feel you. I'm scarred. I got PTSD too. But KO embraces him with a hug, and the elation of the crowd, it was like a release. It was like, yes, we finally did it. You know, there was this writer, former WWE writer on Twitter, Andrew Goldstein, who said, damn, why didn't they save that for WrestleMania? They blew this spot in a thing that nobody cared about, that no one watched, and all this other stuff like that. And I was like, there is no way you could be paying attention to the product if you think that no one watches SmackDown.
That's one. Two, why the fuck would they do it at WrestleMania? What would they have done this week?
Yeah.
If KO turns his back on Sami this week or last week, I'm like, all right, then what are we doing here?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm like, what? We're telling the stories here. Like, multiple stories.
It's their
Why would they beat show? The Usos or lose the Usos and not be friends?
Exactly. It's their biggest show of the week. It's one of their biggest programs of the year so far. Or really of the past year, I'll say that. Not just 2023, 2022 as well. Why the fuck would they not do that at the end of this show so we can get on Monday, which we're going to go to Raw here. Oh, they also announced the WrestleMania showcases too, by the way.
Oh, yeah. Four-way tag team matches. Niggas getting on the card. Shout out to everybody who getting on the card.
Shout out Rick Shea. So leads us to Raw, which they again, Jay's hubris may be their undoing finally. Jimmy says, I don't want to do a rap match at WrestleMania. Also, you guys aren't a real team. Y'all going to turn on each other. We don't turn on each other. We're a real family. And then Jay says, nah, this is a way to put both of them out for good. To which I say, y'all wildin'. If you know how determined these two guys are, and you faced both of them before, you know how determined Sami is, you know how determined KO is, these motherfuckers ain't going to give up if they're together. That's the story. That's the story. But what Raw did was fracture this team way more this week.
Talk about it.
So from there, we realized that Roman hasn't even talked to Jay in the 2 weeks.
Roman pulls up during the promo, and they look at the TV and like, we gotta go.
And he pulls up and has somehow, by the time he gets to the tribal chief room, has seen everything that happened. He said, not a good night for y'all. I said, what? How did you? Did they give you the DVR? Like, what the fuck happened?
He was watching Raw and the Whip.
He saw it on Twitter when they played the clips. Also, another weird part was that he said, all right, everybody get out the room except Jay. Go to the commercial. I said, all right, bet. Back from commercial, they still in the same damn spot that they was in 4 minutes ago before they went to commercial.
Roman said, I got to pee.
Roman said, yo, I gotta peep this John Wick Forge commercial. You seen this shit yet?
But he sits down with Jay, and he's doing the same thing he did when he first got back with Jay. Because he hasn't seen Jay. He realistically has not seen Jay since the Royal Rumble.
Nope.
So he sits down and is like, you know, I gotta know, man. Are you Bloodline? And Jay's like, yeah, I'm Bloodline. You know what I'm saying?
He said, I love you.
I love you. And Jay was like,
yeah. yeah. And then he walked away.
He walked away. I feel him.
What answer do you think Roman was looking for that he got? Because remember, with Roman, the opposite is always true of what he says.
Do he got my back?
No.
What does he say?
He does not have his back.
This is going to be an amazing story. WrestleMania is going to be a movie.
He does not have his back. And to further it even more, because I want to get to the broad strokes, then we'll kind of go deeper into Raw, because we got it. This was a two-show story. You know what I mean? Which is something that we don't see often, where it continued directly into Monday. Cody comes out, interrupts Roman. They get about 15 minutes of promo, I think. Barely.
Nah, they get maybe like 10 minutes. I don't know. I was like, yo, never make me wait 3 hours for Roman Reigns ever. Yeah. Like, no, fuck.
Nah, you tripping. It's big money. Watch that third hour. Watch that third hour. Watch that. Your ass stay, though. Yeah, watch that third hour.
I didn't want to.
H said, sit your ass down and watch that third hour, nigga. He didn't say the N-word, but yeah. Cody comes out. Roman says, you know, the problem isn't you, Cody. You're not the problem. What you represent is the problem. You think you're... Then we get to the real buzzwords here. You believe in pro wrestling, and I'm a fighter. And I say, okay, that's again, like getting the real fans, the smarks riled up so that they won't boo Cody when it's time. That's smart. The kid, he already got the kids. It's getting them adults in. So it's like, oh, he's a pro wrestler. I'm a sports entertainer. Mm-hmm. So that's a smart distinction that he did there. Again, it's layered. It's very layered what they did. Brings up the AEW stuff, says you ran. You didn't want to do Stardust, you ran. You went to a company, you made a company, you couldn't get over there, so you ran away from that. This is the thing that's been kind of getting people in a tizzy, if I'm correct, right? Is that the AEW, he was always over in AEW. What kind of, and again, this isn't like an AEW work shoot where they're doing stuff that could personally make somebody upset.
Mm-hmm.
What Roman was doing is building a program, so it's like, as a heel, you could say that he's lying and doesn't know what he's talking about because he's a bad guy.
Yeah.
Of course he wouldn't know what he's talking about. He's trying to get under Cody's skin. You, as a fan, if you're an AEW fan, you know he was over. But you also know that he stopped being over in that company. And that's where the distinction in the blurred lines come in at. That's the layer part of the promo that people are upset about for some strange reason. I thought it was an effective line. Because, again, this has been about getting under Cody's skin. And I hate that I'm like, kind of turning into English lit professor here, but it's like that is the distinction there. The symbol is insecurity, familial bonds, and how they connect these two, and that's why this story works. Cody then says, "Yeah, you know that all you're saying is true, but I made sure the niggas could get money in the backstage area."
First of all, he said it solo. I see you look at me mean. Shut that shit up, man.
You better cut that shit. He's, hey, if it's Cody the white
man strays.
Is Cody the white, the only white dude in a black group? You know how they always have the crazy white dude?
I mean, might, but
he might be bringing
solo called man strays in this. I was like, damn, Solo, say something, fight back.
But it's about time. It's about time that Solo caught those strays. Because again, the reason why Roman is scared of Cody is because Cody is not scared of Roman. And I think in every instance, you could say Drew wasn't afraid of Roman, but Drew massively overcorrected or over underestimated the powers that Roman had to control his family. And that's why he lost. Because no one hit Roman where it hurts, and that's where his family lies at. So he brought down Solo a couple pegs.
He said, if anyone brings up my father again, I'm going to vomit it, because I'm going to make it clear right now. Nobody needs to bring up my father, because at WrestleMania, but well, he's not going to come down to this ring and hit a bionic elbow. My brother works elsewhere. The only thing you're going to see at WrestleMania is me. And Roman is like, you know, Roman starts to furrow his upper lip. He's like, that, which is great, because there's so many times, and you see this in AEW, and you see this in other promos, like kind of like low-key, kind of like Cena Roman promos, where neither man backs down and shows any sign of being affected clearly, whereas both men are clearly affected by the words that each other is saying. Eventually, Roman decides he's going to leave.
Yeah.
Like, I don't need this.
This is the second time. This is
you'll be a man without a family.
Yeah,
you'll be a chief with no tribe, and you'll be a Roman with no reins. Some bars and shit. Like, it's just something light.
he'd be a chief with no tribe. He said if he loses at Mania April 3rd, the reality is he'll have to know what it feels like to lose. Jay's gonna leave him. Jimmy's gonna go after Jay. Solo's gonna leave too. And then Paul's going to become an advocate again. And again, no one's ever hit Roman. That's to him. That's below the belt. But again, like I said, this is the second or third time Roman has realized I might have fucked up by riling this guy up. Because he's been able to get under Daniel Bryan's head, Edge's head, Cena's head, all of that by his words. Now he's facing somebody that doesn't affect them. The dad's. Yeah, go ahead.
No, and I say you're going to see how this plays out. You're going to see exactly how that plays out when Cody uses his words and it clearly affects Solo. He said, it's like I said, I knew you weren't ready. Crowd is chanting, you're not ready. You're not ready.
Solo doesn't leave the ring. That was the cool part.
He was like, he's ready to go full Samoan. Cody kicks him in the face. Roman Reigns is like, nah, you're not about to punk me. Y'all not about to do this, because y'all going to make me look crazy. Y'all going to make me look stupid. He gets up, runs up on the apron, tells Solo, yo, chill out.
Next week, he says. Next week.
And Solo kind of like, it's like a turtle go back into his shell. Like all that tough shit just kind of like fell backwards. He look a kid, to be honest with you. I mean, he is a kid. Mm-hmm. But you really see it like how the words and the promos and stuff like that, like everything is really getting to Roman at this point. And they use Solo as kind of like a character to kind of like show all of that, to really just kind of like portray that.
But the biggest key here, Meelz, is the reason why Roman didn't want the Usos out there, because he knows he's lost control of them.
And didn't want any of those words to hit deeper like they did with Solo.
Exactly. And he thought Solo wouldn't be affected by those words. And that's why he kept Solo. Because Solo, Meelz, is the last person that Roman has complete and utter control over. And now he's losing that. That's why he didn't want the Usos out there.
Bada bing, bada boom.
Just perfect storytelling. Perfect story.
Hey, man, you know what we can't explain? Why the hell Rhea Ripley was facing Bayley last night?
It's for 20 minutes.
I was like, what the hell is this?
Here's my thing, right? Good ass match. I don't got no problems with that match. It was good. You get Rhea over by having her beat a former SmackDown champion. I get that. I just feel like I feel like Bayley definitely is like, yeah, I'll take this. I'll take this on the chin, because I'm getting something way bigger. I'm already a Mania anyway. You know what I mean? Like, somebody's got to lose here.
Well, Rhea better beat Becky too, damn it.
That ain't happening.
She better beat Becky too. This don't make no damn sense. I'm going to be too close to WrestleMania. Go ahead.
Ain't enough days. There ain't enough days for that to happen.
What else happened on Raw?
Edge, creepy Edge promo.
Shot on the phone.
Yeah, shot on the phone, clearly. You could tell he's an old man. That's probably the iPhone 6, looks like.
Front camera, too.
Yeah, front camera as well. Really good promo, though. It seems as though we're confirmed here. We're Brood Edge versus Demon Finn. Again, I love that rumor came out in January. And I was like, they're definitely going to do that at some point, and they're doing it in Mania, which is to me the bigger show. That entrance is going to be crazy. We've never seen Demon Finn at Mania. I say you go all out with that shit. Like you give him like some of the coolest. Hey, is there a horror movie coming out? Do a partnership with the paint this year. Like call up Disney. Call up Bob Iger. Say, hey, can we use the Venom skin? Come on, man, let's do it.
And then Dominic says that he promises to confront the Mysterio family on SmackDown this week. So we got a couple of stuff for SmackDown this week.
This is technically the go home show this week for all shows, honestly. Like,
yeah, that's gonna happen on SmackDown. We got Cody versus Ludwig Kaiser,
mm-hmm.
Which should be a banger.
I would go ahead and pencil in Cody versus Solo because Roman kept saying next week to him at the end of Raw. So I would pencil that for Phoenix.
We got Bianca Belair and Asuka finally getting their brawl. They getting in their brawling bag too. Asuka said, you know what, fuck her.
Bianca put her arms up too early.
And I don't think she was hit by the second kick either.
Yeah. She put her legs up. Put her hands up too early.
I feel like they talked to Asuka in the back and it was like, please.
Please don't knock her out.
WrestleMania is in 10 days. Do not kick the shit out of her.
So with some weirdness with Chelsea Green and Carmella and Piper, is Carmella okay?
I have no idea. I haven't heard any news about it.
That was weird. What else happened? Austin Theory went 2-0 on the Street Profits. It don't sit right in my soul that he just beat these two niggas back to back.
It really don't, but we see what they're doing. Yeah. They're soft launching the split.
Yeah. So something's got to give with these two, I think, very soon. What else happened on Raw here? Oh, Dominic not only said that, but to go back to your Dominic point, he brought up what I felt as though they should have did and bring the family into it. So I think that's smart as well. What else happened? There was something else I really liked on Raw.
Seth Rollins and Logan Paul. Logan Paul's a great promo.
Logan Paul is quite a promo, don't you think?
He's really good. Self-awareness.
Yeah. He's
a long way.
And then Seth, again, the way they're booking or creating a story around the punch to me is very good because they never really got a chance to get that off with Roman because he still had to be infallible. You know what I mean? Like, you can tell that it's something that they're being very careful with to show, but also something that they're going to use in to their advantage when the match actually happens. And I would expect this to be a sleeper match of the weekend. They confirmed that it's night one on Raw. So they did confirm that it's going to be on Logan's birthday on April 1st. So that's going to be fun. That's going to be a fun one.
I agree. I absolutely agree.
You had, what do you feel about Otis before we get out of here?
You know me.
Come on, man. You got to admit it's funny.
It's funny.
All right. You're going to give him his just due, man.
I'm not. That's the thing. I'm asking, man.
All right. All right. Okay, well, that was this week. We got a huge, huge week that we're gonna announce to you guys very, very soon about what's going to happen, how we're going to release these things. But the Mania prediction show is going to be crazy. I cannot wait to share all the guests that we have on this with you guys. Some guests that we've never had before. Some guests that you wouldn't even think that would even have been on our show, which is what I'm really excited about. You know what I mean? Because we usually kind of like, we have a pool of guests, you know what I mean? And we love them to death. But I think that the guests we have here are like really, really awesome. And I mean, the one we shot one yesterday, Meelz, it went almost an hour. You know what I mean? And it was really, really good. So I can't wait for you guys to hear that.
Absolutely. You can tune into that next week. Of course, we'll be doing a giveaway next week. Make sure you stay tuned to all of our socials to be, you know, abreast of the giveaway. We also got our Draft Diaries WrestleMania 19. 20 years later, we're talking about it, Justin and I. If you're on Patreon, you can hear the full episode where we also talk about Jay-Z's 2003. But those of you who are on public who are not yet subscribed, what is wrong with you? Make sure you put that $5, get the whole thing, get the whole series, Draft Diaries from an entirety. You're able to listen to it, talk to it, absorb it, all these other things like that. And also, yeah, you know what? That's all I want to announce for now.
Yeah, well, we got a huge show for you guys next week. And thank you for listening to this week. Thanks to everybody who had questions and sent in stuff for office hours. We love doing office hours. And I want to do more of those. I want to keep uplifting and helping all the people that are trying to get it, just like we used to. So thank you guys for listening. And for next week, until next week, rather, we'll see you then. For Meelz, I'm Justin. Thank you for listening to The A Show. Peace.